performed by Biswajit Ratta and Party. This is the general overseas service of All India Radio. We now bring you the program Our Guest, wherein we feature an interview with Professor Balram Singh, who's founder of Index Center at University of Massachusetts, Dartmouth. He's being interviewed by Amlan Jyoti Mazumdar.
My name is Balram Singh. I live in Boston area. I've been teaching at the University of Massachusetts for 25 years, and now I run my own institute called Institute of Advanced Sciences, in which we do research on something related to yoga, Ayurveda, and also my major area of research in chemistry is on botulinum neurotoxins, more popularly known as Botox. I have very varied experience and interest. Some of them is related to, of course, science, some fundamental scientific ideas. Some of them are inspired now by Indian culture and traditions. But also, the basic ideas about thermodynamics or quantum data and this overlaps with some concepts in India about Vedanta and how the cosmos runs, how the evolution happens. So I have those fundamental interests. But also, I have interest in Indian philosophy, particularly Indian philosophy of yoga and Vaisheshika. I've had quite a bit of interest and I taught a course at the university for 10 years. It's called Science of Kriya Yoga. The only course on yoga which was meeting the requirement of science. Supposedly, the most powerful form of yoga and a very elite school of yoga. The Kriya Yoga is the Yogananda style of yoga. There is a lot of following of that. In the United States, actually, Swami Vivekananda was the first who introduced yoga to the United States. But in practical sense, Paramahansa Yogananda was the one who really carried it through and taught people technique. And that is something that is still continuing. And it's something that people can do and understand. And as a scientist, it was easy for me to say it is yoga in essence, that Kriya Yoga is something to do. And so you can understand that much better. Students really like physics and metaphysics, including neuroscience in it.
Well, that includes an impressive list of 13 books and over 300 articles.
That's true. I have been very fortunate, actually. And in some sense, because of coming from India as a culture, it's like a very diverse. Also, my former training is in biophysical chemistry, so it's like three fields. So I'm trained to be open-minded, and then we established a center called Center for Index Studies at the University of Massachusetts, and I was the founding director of that. So I was kind of force-fed information because, you know, as a director, you get a lot of people who come from seminars and talks and conferences. So I became a beneficiary of all kind of
For the benefit of our listeners, could you please explain what Indic studies is?
Indic studies is related to Indian culture, Indian philosophy, Indian art, Indian music, and Indian traditions. So basically, all encompassing Indian. Sometimes people ask me why not Indian. And this is a very interesting question because in America, there is a native population that is known as Indian, they're known as American Indians. So if you say Indian, people misunderstand it. So that was one reason why we wanted to call it Indic. But once some people get confused, well, they think it's something related to Vedic. Of course it is related to Vedic also. It's related to everything else. It's just like one thing in academia, we call it academic. So if you are Indian, it's called Indic.
How has been your connection with India since you have lived abroad for so long? And how do you compare standards of research in USA and in India in a scientific temple as well as in the Indic studies as we are talking about?
Well, first of all, I'm connected to the very root of India. My family comes from a village and all my family members still live in the village. And so I'm very much connected with the bottom of India and to the top of the United States. When you're a professor, I mean, that's about all they can get to in terms of intellectual prowess or intellectual understanding. So I've been very fortunate. So I come to India 5-6 times a year. I've been living in the United States for 36 years. And only one time missed to go to my village in all my trips. I always go there. My understanding of India is that's why it's very foundational on one hand and very modern on the other. And mostly we are utilitarian scientists in India. We basically try to find something from the rest of the world and try to use it. A lot of times we waste our time in copying it, in imitating it, which is against fundamental tenets of science. So at the beginning actually they are very practical. We just import technologies as an example. But we are not contributing anything to running around where we are being very theoretical. Whether can we make it very practical? Absolutely. India actually by culture is a very practical thing. But Indians have this tradition of philosophizing, of course thinking about it. Basically tarka. There is all kind of Hindi words in it. Our sages and saints have been science, which has then become science. And in Indian tradition it's known as darshan. Darshan by means basically you have seen it through. It's very complicated. We do have theoretical stuff which we need. We do need to make it practical eventually, that we must. But we should do it all this on our own terms rather than just copying from the best and calling it practical.
So, would you agree if I say that in a country like ours, with our social milieu and the milieu we have, even in the field of science, we need more of a bottom-up approach rather than a top-down model?
Very true. I agree with that. I think we need to have a bottom-up approach, but then somebody has to design that bottom-up approach. And then obviously bottom-up people cannot. So somebody with the full appreciation, sensitivity, and knowledge of what is that bottom-up. For example, a lot of traditions in the villages, which are very scientific, but we kind of throw them in the trash because we do not want to consider them because they are Mahati, they are rural people. When my mother was alive, every day she will put some water in the neem tree. And I used to make fun of her when I was in high school. And I used to ask her, why do you put this? Because she wouldn't eat or drink anything unless she puts water. She has to take bath and then put water in the neem tree. And then she said, there is Sitla Mata in it. And so I used to climb up and shake the tree and see where the Sitla Mata is. And now I work in infectious diseases. And I now know much better about neem tree. And I know about the patents that have been issued for neem tree. So then you understand, oh my God, since the tradition is the oldest lady of the house will have to do this. It means he cannot walk too far. It has to be mixed in house. Then you get all these antiseptic elements of neem tree pervading all your house, which is then kills viruses, bacteria, and other kind of things, or fungi, which is like a natural way of doing it. Now, whether they knew exactly what I'm telling you, it probably doesn't even matter. They probably knew some other way. And they called it Sitla Mata or whatever. And so people practice that. Numerous practices like this about health, about Ayurveda, about yoga, what people do, or festivals. Festivals are full of celebration. I mean, you hardly can ever get depressed. Depression is the biggest problem in the West. But in India, they have festivals everywhere. People might think, including myself, that sometimes, you know, I want to have transaction in the bank or something, the banks are closed. Because it's a this of all of that. So it's kind of annoying. I think maybe doing a digital mouth sound for the problem. I can have festivals and things can also keep going. But what I was saying is that there is a lot of information, a lot of tradition, both at the very theoretical level as maybe in yoga class, for example. The fundamentals about science is that you have to be objective. And the reason we say we have to be objective is so that you are not biased. Now, every, I am a scientist, I am